Yeah, what is up, everybody? Happy Monday. Ginger Runner Live, episode number 215.
Special early time tonight.
Special early time tonight. We are an hour earlier to accommodate our guest schedule. He's a busy man, and especially this week, Western States 100. Happy Statesmas, everybody. It is this weekend, this Saturday, it begins. From Squaw Valley to Auburn, the first 100-mile race, the big one. We are not going to be there this year. Unfortunately, we have some family stuff that we're taking care of this weekend, but I can't wait to spend the next 5 days planning and plotting and predicting and wringing the hands about the weather, like what's it going to do, talking all about Western States 100 this weekend. It's going to be warm. But as our guest tonight has already told me, it's going to be fun. Like, he's excited about it. And I'm like, oh, my God. Our guest is probably one of the biggest legends in the sport. I can't believe it's taken us 215 episodes to get this guy on. Carl Meltzer is going to be joining us on tonight's show. I'm fangirling out, fanboying out, fanning out, everything that could be possible right now. Definitely a little nervous because this guy is pretty much as legit as they come. Regardless, welcome everyone to tonight's show. Sit back, relax, grab your beverage of choice. Ginger Runner Live begins now. Ginger Runner. Yes, yay. What is up, everybody? Welcome to Ginger Runner Live. Thank you for taking time out of your busy schedules to join us on tonight's show. Episode number 215, featuring one of the best, winningest ultra runners on the planet Earth. Carl Meltzer is joining us on tonight's show. This has been the case for quite a while, but he is the winningest 100-mile distance runner. I don't know if that sentence makes sense. I'm trying to think of that. Basically, he's won the most hundreds of anyone else on Earth at 40. He's won 40 100-mile races.
you'll get it out eventually.
But that's a sentence that, like, it just never gets spoken.
Right, exactly.
It's pretty amazing. Our guest is knowledgeable in the sport beyond, I think, anything that I can comprehend. He's been doing this since the late 90s, maybe before that. I don't know. He doesn't look a day over 25, but for all I know, he's going to tell me I've been running since 1950. I don't know. Carl Meltzer is going to be joining us here in just a second. Before we introduce our guest, we have a lot of people to thank. All of our Patreon supporters. Thank you, everyone who's supported us on Patreon over the last year and months. If you are new to the Patreon game, we really, really appreciate it. It basically allows us to do this full time, do the podcast every week, do videos every week. So thank you very much. Three individuals in particular at the top tier allow us to do this full time. Chris Lee from Hong Kong. Chris is a fantastic ultra runner, also runs the organization Trailblazer. Over there showcasing all the trails that they have in beautiful Hong Kong. Recently raised $10,000 for charity. Just a fantastic dude. Big shout out to Chris Lee. Rick Bjarnason and his team at CheekyMonkeyMedia.ca. It's a Canadian web design company, but they are currently redesigning the Ginger Runner website, which I'm excited to share with you guys here very, very soon. But Rick is an ultra runner, training currently for Sinister 7 and Fat Dog 120. Had some huge mileage weekends a couple weeks back, and I'm going to talk to him actually in probably this week or next week about what he's doing right now for training because his races are coming up. So big shout out to Rick, badass ultra runner. And finally, Brian Sands, who I believe is back from his exotic vacation to Hawaii, but he ran his first marathon last October. I believe he's 7 weeks out from his first ultra, 50K. It's been great to follow along with his journey. He's lost over 100 pounds in his journey. Brian, let us know what you're up to now as far as weight loss. It's been amazing to follow this guy. Super inspirational. So big shout out to those three individuals for supporting us and supporting the show and the community. It's pretty awesome to have them. We are also joined by the lovely Kim.
Hi, guys. I'm back.
Welcome back.
I wasn't here last week. As a lot of you guys know, our dog had a pretty major medical emergency situation.
Yeah, his jaw was removed.
Yeah, he had his lower jaw removed last week, so I was busy taking care of the poor little guy last week, and he's right here. You guys can't see him, but He's doing much better.
He's much better. And Kim is back. And you're going to be in the chat room for the show?
Yeah, as always, I'll be in the chat room. So we are live. So if you guys have questions for our guest, please pop them into the chat room. There's already a lot of questions rolling in.
Yeah.
No surprise.
No surprise. Our guest tonight, let's get this guy on air here. Again, has won 40 100-mile races, has run obviously much more than that, run well over 100 ultramarathons. You look at his ultra sign-up, and you end up getting dizzy with the amount of scrolling because it just goes and goes and goes. And the first place finishes or podium finishes are endless. So we're going to pick his brain as much as possible tonight. Without further ado, the one, the only, Mr. Carl Meltzer.
Yeah. Yay!
How are you, my friend?
I'm doing all right. Thanks for having me. I'm laying in bed, as you can see. Ready to start on Saturday. And glad this year I'm not going off the couch like I did the last two previous times. So feeling good about the race, but 100 miles, you never really know what's going to happen. Pretty excited about it.
Yeah, I was going to say, I love the taper. Your taper looks extremely comfortable. You've been at this for a long time, so I think that you know exactly what you're doing. What does your taper look like? Because you run so many races like this, 100 miles. What does your taper look like?
Yeah, I mean, I typically only run about 60 to 70 miles per week. Which doesn't really sound like very much to some people, but it's a lot of mountain miles. About 2 weeks out of the race, I'll run something 18, 20 miles or something like that. And from that point, I really kind of can gauge where I'm at. And then I just, I probably take 5 days off. That's, say, 14 days leading to the race. So really it's more about rest than it is, tuning myself up. Because a 100-mile race, even at Western States, run 15 hours. Even though I won't run 15 hours, that's a 9-minute. Not very fast, and I can comfortably run a 9 miles. The way I look at it is that it's really more important to be rested on that start line to feel like you're real peppy at the start. It's almost okay to feel sluggish at the beginning because you got 70 miles to warm up before the race really begins at mile 7.
Nice. I just want to point out, I think if you have the audio turned up on your laptop, Carl, maybe just turn it down just a little bit. I think we're getting a little bit of audio interference. But I got pretty much everything that you said there, no problem. So this is just being a perfectionist there.
Yeah, is that any better?
Go ahead, say again.
Is that any better right now, audio?
Yeah, totally. I think what it was doing was compensating for my volume and that sort of thing. I'm really curious. You're wearing the shirt. 100 miles isn't, is not that far. This is something that when I started in ultra running, people told me all about Carl Meltzer. They told me about that phrase, that saying. Do you still believe that? Is that something that you've taken with you as a mantra throughout all of these journeys? Is that 100 miles is not that far?
Well, it really isn't that far, right? I mean, if you think about it, sure, running 100 miles, I didn't say it was easy. I just said it wasn't that far. So, there is a difference there. And I'll never say that it's easy, but if you think about it, we live a long time, right? I mean, a 100-mile race, whether you're in the back of the pack, the front of the pack, or whatever it is, it's one effort. You're not going to sleep. You're not resting. So I kind of think of it as one day, whether it's 30 hours or, 17 hours or whatever. So I just, that whole process is that it's one time. I mean, get it done, right? I mean, get off your ass, get the thing done, and you're done. There's no bullshit about it. And I just, when I feel bad and I have low points in a race, I just tell myself, 100 miles is not that far, and just blink and I'll be done. Whether it hurts or not, that's another thing. But that's, I think it really helps me mentally get through the race without really worrying about it too much. I don't typically worry about anything anyway. So, 100 miles is not that far. It's, people say they can't drive 100 miles. I laugh at them and then I move on.
I feel like that's one of the most common responses we get when we talk about any of the races we run or the distances. It's like, oh, I don't even want to drive that far. And you think
that's
about it,
you're the like, right there. That is always the answer. Yeah.
It's, the questions have been piling up in my brain for you. I feel like this is such a gift to be able to have you on the show. So I apologize if to both the audience and to Carl, if for some reason the questions are in this kind of discombobulated fashion, because in my mind, I'm like, I got to ask Carl this. I got to ask him that. Before we get into states this year, I'm just really curious. Let's just start here as far as the sports change over the last few decades. So you've been a part of the sport for so long since not the inception, of course, but you've been a part of it for decades. How do you see it changing, or how has it changed for you, for better or for worse? Are there things that are like, I'm so glad technology is playing a role in it, or what are some of the positives and negatives that you've seen?
Well, I'm still using the same technology. I still have my Casio watch. I don't have GPS or anything. I started in 96.
That's awesome.
So, yeah, 22 years. But, you know, it's certainly gotten faster. I mean, that's going to happen with any sport. Basketball players get bigger and stronger. Golfers hit it further, whatever. And it's gotten faster. But and there's more people in it. And I think that's great that more people are getting out and they're doing it and they're challenging themselves. I mean, that's awesome. You know, competition's stronger. I mean, these are all kind of the no-brainer answers. But what I do like about it is that you go to, you know, 99% of the races, it's still the same thing. It's still camaraderie is awesome. Front runners mingle with the back runners, you know, things like that. So I think it really hasn't changed all that much other than the amount of people doing it, you know. And there's been, I think, there's a little bit of saturation with how many races there are, which I think is, at this point right now, not necessarily a good thing, but at the same time, it brings more people. It's kind of like a catch-22 both ways. I think it's all positive the way it's gone, and I hope it continues. You know, I hope that if I'm still doing this when I'm, you know, 80, it's still the same. I hope to go to races. Even the race I put on, Speed Go 50K, I like to see it really competitive, but at the same time, I try to bring that atmosphere to just be like a sort of like a family event in a certain way, you know, so everybody has it's the sport's been great. It's been really good to me. So why not try to pass that on to others?
Yeah, no doubt. And, you know, I, of course, I'd be remiss to not point out the fact that you are a part of so many different facets of the sport. Not only are you a sponsored elite runner, you do attend races and you win races, but you also are a race director and you've done lots of just fun adventures out there. So you're kind of dabbling in all facets and have for a long time. I have to make sure to point that out. Again, I want to remind everyone that we are live with Carl Meltzer. If you have questions for him, please jump into the chat room. Kim is keeping an eye on it, and we have tons of questions already. So let's get to some of those. Babe, what do we got?
Yeah, a question from Jesse Palmer in the chat room. Jesse asked, Carl, I'm making my first jump to 50 miles this fall. What's your one piece of sage advice from all your ultra experience?
That's a pretty standard question, but the whole thing is that you want, number one, respect the distance. It's important to do that, but don't go into it with real, don't go into it with super time goals. You know, I think many times people will go into a race that says, if I ran a marathon this fast, I should run a 50 miler this fast. I think go into it and learn from it and expect there to be challenges and then take those challenges to the next race and see how you do. You know, I could say don't go out too fast, but that's, you know, no shit. Don't go out too fast, right? But the thing is, you have to understand that you're out there, you get to run all day supported. And what really, if you like to trail run, what really is better than that? You know, every 7 or 8 miles you get, you know, resupplied or whatever it is. And you have to embrace the suck, enjoy the fun, and just kind of know that you do it because you like it, you know? Don't worry about the watch so much the first couple of times. I mean, you really never know what you're going to run on a particular course because every course is different. Everyone has time goals, but you don't really know what's going to happen out there. Once you do it once and you go back a second time, then maybe you can address those time goals. But first time, go out, have fun, and just try to stay in the game and run reasonably decent to the end, and you'll come back hungry for more every time.
There's a good comment here from Amber in the chat room, and that dovetails nicely with the question that we were talking about a little bit earlier, just regarding the changes to the sport. Is there anything that you would like to see change in the sport?
I don't know if I'd like to see much actually change. I think it's, like I said, there's a little extra saturation with races. I think some race directors are going a little overboard of having too many. But for me, I put on one event or one day of two races now, but I don't want to expand to more because I'm not trying to take away from anyone else. You know, I think we should stop having a certain amount of races as long as they're filling up and that kind of thing. And I just think really that's about it. I like the way it's progressing. I mean, sure, there's some negatives about it with competition and testing and things like that. But I think that's good. But I think we just need to just keep doing what we're doing. And it's going to keep growing, and it'll stay positive all the time if we keep doing that.
So you mentioned this earlier, and I imagine over the last 22 years plus of ultra running for yourself and adventuring and the like, you talked about hitting low spots. So it's often that ultra runners believe that the elite, the front of the pack, they don't hit low spots, or if they do, they're not as harsh as their own, right? People are always comparing, like, oh, well, their bonk is easier than my bonk. My bonk's harder. Can you talk about some of the lows that maybe you've hit, or how do you get through them? What are the ways that Carl Meltzer gets through those spots where you don't want to finish a race, or you want to quit, or your body's telling you no?
Well, I tell myself 100 miles is not that far. but no, I think I mean, at this point in my career, like you said, I've run about 140 ultras. I've run about 800 miles, right? So I'm going to have low points or bonks or tough times. I mean, I've done the Appalachian Trail 3 times. I mean, how many times did I have a low points then? Every day, right? So the whole idea about having low points, you sort of have to laugh at it and say, oh, here's my low point. Here we go, you know? And usually your low point comes from either, you know, not enough food, not enough calories, not enough sugar. The second you put a little bit of food into your body again, that low point a lot of times disappears. I mean, obviously, if you're puking it up, that's a problem. But you know, you have to laugh at these things and say this is part of it. I've run, you know, like I said, about 800s, and I've had about 4 or 5 that were really perfect, you know? So you have to remember that, well, I'm going to have a low point at some point. I hope not to have one Saturday, but I expect to have a low point.
Sure.
But I'll laugh at that, you know. It's like, well, here we go. Here's the low point. How do I get out of that? So I try to stay positive, and then, you know, I eat another gel or whatever it is, and I just keep trying to move forward. You have to take it with a grain of salt, you know, the typical cliche saying, but that's how you have to do it. When you start getting down on yourself, start getting negative, it becomes a whirlpool spiral, and then kind of down you go. As far as, like, you know, an elite runner having a low point, not as bad as someone, you know, a little further behind, is, it's not true. I mean, we see what happens at Western every year. There's carnage every year from the fast runners.
Yep.
And that, no one likes to see that. I don't want to see that. But at the same time, they suffer too. We're all suffering. So you have to respect the fact that you're going to suffer, kind of talk yourself out of it and move on. And again, it's one effort. You know, if it's 36 hours or 30 hours at Western or whatever it is, you got to talk yourself out of it and know that when you cross that finish line, you're going to be happy about it or psyched about it. If you go home with your tail between your legs at mile 80 and you're standing at the finish lines, you know, feeling okay, then you didn't talk yourself out of it. You know, you kind of failed in a way. Then you have a down low for about a couple of weeks while you're bummed out. It doesn't matter what your time is across that finish line. It's getting there that matters. And even for, you know, I've run races where I finished kind of crappy, had a bad last patch or whatever. But finishing was far more important to me than that time. And then I felt way better. I was like, well, I got it done anyway. At least I finished the thing instead of going home early. So you got to just think of the positive things are when you get across that line and how good you're going to feel.
No doubt. Again, we are live, so keep the questions coming. Kim's already pulled a bunch aside, and we're going to get to some of those now. Let's get to some of the live questions.
Yeah, a question from Assorted Adventures. Question for Carl. What was your very first experience of running 100 miles like? Did you immediately know that this was your distance, or did this not happen until you had tried several times?
My first 100 was the Wasatch 100, 1996, which was also my first ultramarathon. So, hey, you know... Maybe that's when I knew it was my distance. I don't
know. Go big. But, it's not that far.
It's not that far. But, yeah, I mean, I didn't know what I was doing. I didn't know why there was salt on the table, you know. But I went to it with, you know, I didn't have any expectations on time. My goal was to finish, which was important instead of having these time expectations. But I got through 40 miles. I was leading the race with a guy named Tim Spence. And, yeah, I was a fast, shorter distance runner, but I had no clue what I was doing at 100. Leading the race at mile 40. By the time 45 came around, I started to blow up. Wheels came off, walked to the finish. At mile 93, I got lost for an hour and a half. But not one time in that race did I think, well, I'm going to drop out. I'm going to finish. And, of course, like everyone else says, I got to the end. I'll say I'll never do it again. 2 days later, I was like, where do I sign up? That was my first experience at 100. And I suffered, you know. Of course I suffered. But following year, I went back. I came in seventh. IT Van Blue. I came in seventh. The following year, I won Wasatch and broke the record in 98. And that's when I said, wow, this is kind of fun, you know? I mean, it's kind of fun when you win. It never gets old, right? But I really think I knew it was my distance in 2001 when I won Hard Rock. And in 26:39, which that record's been beaten by 4 hours now, but that's not important. At that time, I had a really great race, and I was like, man, really like how the strategy pans out. You know, I'm okay at the 50K. I was okay at the 50-miler, but the strategy behind 100 is so much different than shorter race that if you're a slower runner, you can still win. And I'm not really a fast runner. I just mentally know that a 100-miler, anything can happen. I don't care if the guy's out there running a 31-minute 10K. It's not always the fastest by the time he gets to the finish line. So that's what I really liked about the 100. I was intrigued by it. And then when I won those, you know, that was maybe my second or third win at 100 miles that year. And that's when I said to myself, you know, I'm going to focus on one thing, which was 100, and I'm going to try to win more than anyone else. And that was after winning like three times. And Ann Trayson had the most of the time with 22. So I sort of focused on that 100, and I got better and better and better at it. And now, even if I'm out of shape, I'll go after it off the couch. I mean, I won't run as fast as I could, but at the same time, I know how to do it. I know how to strategize it, know when not to push, which is essentially the first 60 miles of the race. I just know how to do it, and I like it. I like the strategy. So that's when I sort of knew. 2001 was really, I think, the time that turned my head and said, this is what I want to focus on.
That's cool. I mean, you talk a bit about strategy, and we've seen it every year. We talk about states, or we talk about any of the big hundreds and going into it. You know, who do we predict is going to do what? It always benefits those who are patient and smart with their days. And I mean, Carl, I think we can definitely say, because of your resume and your experience, that you've got to learn this firsthand. You've probably seen people go out too fast or blow up, and you've been able to just be consistent throughout the day. I anticipate that's probably going to play a role in this weekend's race, especially with what we're seeing the weather do. What did you say before the show? Like, the temperatures are going to be hot. How does that make you feel?
Hot?
Makes hot.
Me feel hot? No, I'm not. I mean, I'm, you know, honestly, you know, you have to embrace it. It's not hot just for me. It's hot for everyone.
Right.
And I think, you know, the 2 years that I did run Western, 1 year was a scorcher, the year that I came in 11th. And I kind of blew up the last 20 miles, but I learned a lot this year. But my focus that year wasn't about trying to run top 10, trying to run a certain time. It was trying to stay cool. So every single time that I crossed a little water crossing or creek or something like that, even when I was really sore and I could barely bend over and reach the water, I did that and I splashed myself. I got myself wet. I did things like that to make myself feel better. And my stomach was never a problem that year. It was just, I was kind of off the couch and my quads were destroyed, but which is typical. But I mean, this year, if it's going to be extra hot, you know, you throw the times out the door and you try to stay cool. And that's what I'm going to do again. Whatever the time is to finish, I mean, I hope it's under 18:42, but at the same time, if it's not, it's okay. I just took care of myself. And, you know, you say how, you know, a lot of times these guys go out fast and they blow, but I mean, cheers to them too. There's nothing wrong with going for it. And once in a while, someone will pull that off, you know? So, and I love to see it. You know, I'm 50 years old now, so I'm not really racing to win anything. Well, no, especially Western States. But at the same time, I'm just racing to run a good race for the finish. And if I do that, then it's a success. Whether I come in, you know, fifth or sixth or 25th, it really doesn't matter to me that much. It's just about having out there and having fun with it. So I just try to embrace whatever the weather is. If it was thunderstorms, if it was snowing, I ran a snow bear 1 year at the Bear 100, and it was 14 degrees at one point, and it was snowing, and it was cold as shit, but I embraced that. I prepared for it, and I just did it, you know. You got to embrace what it is. You can't be worried about the heat. Everyone else is hot, too. So I don't really – I'm not worried about the heat. Did I do any heat training? No. I'm running the hot weather. So walked around the Needles District today in the Canyonlands, and it's 90. It's hot enough. I'm not worried about it, you know. I take everything grain of salt. I stay laid back, and I'm just going to do whatever I got to do to get to the finish line.
I think you've got the experience. I feel like of all the people that can, right, I feel like after 20 plus years of doing this, and especially the 100 mile distance with 80 finishes, Carl knows what he's talking about as far as, you know, you deal with the cards as they come, and you deal with it on at the time. And if it's going to be hot, Carl's fully aware it's going to be hot. It seems like he's ready for it. Again, live questions. Let's get to some of these.
Yeah, I was just going to mention that there's a few people bringing up Jeff Browning's name as far as like somebody else who would share kind of the philosophies of what you're talking about.
We're big Browning fans. Yeah.
Running smart.
No, I am as well. I mean, Jeff and I are good buddies. And Jeff, again, like me, he will wait. And, you know, he's really fit right now. So I can vouch for that. I've run with him a couple times. And I know he'll do well. He's done his heat training, apparently. But, yeah, Browning and I, we run very similar. He's a couple years younger than I am. He's definitely faster than I am. And I think he'll run a really smart race. You know, he's sort of, in a sense, he's actually a wild card to win in my book, you know, because Jeff will run smart. And he's got one thing in the back of his head that, you know, that Mike Morton record over 40 is kind of tingling his neck a little bit. So we'll see what Bronco can do. But at the same time, he won't go out fast and try to break that record. He'll let it come to him. And that's how records are broken, is sort of when they come back to you. I've always said that the records come on special days. So, you know, we'll see what Jeff does. And I know he'll run well. I'm not going to see him. I'll see him at the finish with a beer probably. And he'll be there a long time before I will. But I wish him the best to have a really good race. And I think he's definitely a person to learn from as well. He's won, I think he told me, 1600s now. So he and I are 1 and 2 now in the 100 mile for men anyway. But it's been an honor to run with that guy a lot and really get to know him and his strategies and things like that. But we are very similar. And if you think about it, we've both been around for a long time. And we both are best. That's probably our best distance is 100. So, yeah. Learn from Jeff, too.
Yeah, we've had him on the show a couple times, and I feel like it's just like talking to you, where you just, the experience is there, and it's obvious, and you just hear it in the stories or the experiences that are shared. And, yeah, a lot of knowledge dropped, even on today's show already. So this is super helpful for our viewers and for us and everything like that. Yeah. Let's get to one more.
Yeah.
Then we'll start talking about states.
Sure. Question from Kim Wrinkle in the chat room. Kim asks, Carl, you never use pacers. Is at least having a crew important to your racing success? If so, what do you want or expect from a crew? If not, how do you compensate?
I think it's good to have crew. I don't like to use pacers because I feel just I'm better by myself. I train by myself. I mean, I'm not against pacers. It's fine. It's legal. You know, it's all good. Do what you want. But I honestly feel better. I mean, no one's going to make me run faster. Even pacers with other people, they're friends with them running. I think it is a little bit of assistance, especially when it gets dark, because the light is an assistance. But whatever, you know, do what you got to do. I could use one if I wanted to, too. So it's all good. But I do better when I do things myself. And I've learned the hard way many times. With everything that I do, I learned the hard way. Kind of taught myself how to play golf a little bit. So, and I got pretty decent about that too after a while. So, I'll run alone. And when I'm having that low point, I'll talk myself out of it. You know, when I was on the Appalachian Trail, no one really ran with me much, maybe 2% of the time, if that. But I like that. I like being out there on alone and challenging myself. It's just how I do it. And I feel more satisfied that I did it alone. And that's still really pretty much my view on having pacers. As far as crew goes, I've always been very quick at aid stations. I don't like to waste time. So my wife, Cheryl, is she's the greatest crew ever. I mean, if I'm there longer than 2 minutes, I've been there a long time. So you'll see me go through in 30 seconds pretty much every time that anyone watching will see us. All I really take, I slam a Red Bull usually. I grab some more gel. I'll eat some pineapple and strawberries. And, you know, the light, changing out the lights or anything like that, is just like it's already on a crew sheet for her to do. But she knows already what to do. So I just try to be more efficient and gain time in those locations because, again, I'm not really a fast runner. But if you run the whole time and you have, you know, 10 minutes of downtime in a 100 miler, you're probably gaining time on 99.5% of the field. So that's kind of one way that I try to gain time. And Cheryl is a big, big part of that. So, you know, I could do it alone, too. I've run some great races without any crew. And I will say that a lot of times, because you're the leader, people at the aid stations already have your drop bag for you. So I kind of have aid station crew. But at the same time, crew is super important for people, and I think they should try to refine their strategies like that a little bit, because many times if they look back at races and say, well, I did great, but I was fighting a cutoff. Well, look at how much time you spend sitting in a chair or standing there talking. If your crew is too large, two people is the max you should ever have, I think. I don't care who you are, because once people start asking you questions, then what's this? What's that? Do you need this? Do you need that? Do you need? Do you, how does this feel? What's going on? If you don't have those people asking you questions, you're not thinking about that kind of stuff. So I don't let Cheryl ask the questions. She puts stuff down in front of me. I kind of look at it. It's basically garbage, gel, reload my water bottles, which are kind of leapfrogged out from other bottles, and I'm gone. So I don't let her ask me too many questions to confuse me, because we all get confused, late in a race. So you want to keep it as simple as possible. Pace charts as part of a crew thing. I run with a Casio. I mean, I could run without a watch at Western, and it wouldn't make a difference to me. I don't work. Pace charts don't matter either. Getting too technical and thinking too much is to me, it's a waste of energy and a waste of stress. I just kind of do my thing, and my crew knows what they're doing. They lay it out for me, and I'll take care of it, and I'm out. So simplicity is really the factor that I'm pretty proud of, not having much time in aid stations.
Well, I mean, this is even an interesting conversation to kind of compare on how the sport has changed a little bit. I don't remember where I saw this dialogue happening, but just the idea of now people are able to use pacers. There is all this technology that helps people track every stat, every cadence or heart rate, and all the ability with nutrition to just grab something that has the exact number of calories, the electrolytes that you need. Is there something about that you don't enjoy? That it sounds like you're able to keep things just super simple. You don't need the pacers. You want your crew minimal. You probably already have nutrition kind of dialed down to a certain thing. Do you wish it was like that always, kind of that simplicity or?
Well, I think simplicity is good. I mean, I know that about 200 calories an hour for me is on the edge. If I take, most people, if they take too much, it's not a buffet out there where you want to eat so much food, because all that does is think of that food going down the funnel. Well, when the funnel gets clogged up, it comes back, So I sort of treat it like an IV drip. I've always said, treat your food like an IV drip. And I look at my watch when I take a gel. I say, okay, 25 minutes from now, I'm going to take another one. So I pay attention to that. But other than that, it's just a simple thing, is that you slowly IV drip your food into you, and that's all you really got to do. I mean, water the same thing. You can easily overdrink. Even at Western, you can overdrink. You just have to understand that drinking isn't the only way to stay cool. External hydration, whatever, or pouring water over your head or ice or whatever, is really, really important. And drinking 40 ounces of water per hour, if you do that, you're just going to get nauseous and you're going to feel like crap. So you've got to find that fine line of what works for you. And I just kind of found that. I mean, I'm going to use the watch a little with the gel, but late in the race, I started eating more gels because I'm just depleted, I've learned how to treat myself just the right amount of fuel to get it done.
I like that. And even our chat room is saying the same thing, of just loving Carl's advice of keeping it simple. The simplicity is, it's refreshing, because, so often we have guests on that talk about their entire strategy or their plan, and just to hear keeping it simple and keeping the calories to what you can handle and the liquid to what you can handle might be
I mean, gadgets successful. Are good too. The gadgets of your heart rates and all those things. The thing about the heart rate monitor for me, what I don't understand about that is, if you're a mountain runner and you're going up and down hills all the time, how do you really regulate your heart rate? I can't keep my heart rate at 180 if I'm running down a mountain on a smooth trail. It doesn't work that way. It just won't go that high. When you're on a track, running around in circles or on a bike or something like that, it's certainly easier to monitor. But in this kind of condition, you sort of have to feel I'm sucking wind. I'm tired. I should slow down. That's how I regulate my heart rate. I guess I've done enough of it that I understand what's too much work and what isn't. My other strategy too, I'll mention this to the viewers too, is that when I walk up that first hill out of Spa and the other hills anytime early in the race, my goal is to not feel lactic acid in my muscles, that burn, right? So if I'm walking up a hill and I'm feeling that burn, I'll slow down. I don't care if 10 guys go by me. That doesn't matter. because that lactic acid buildup is going to catch up to you later and burn your legs. So I try to stay away from that as much as I can early. I mean, it's going to come eventually. But at the same time, if you stay away from that feeling through, you know, 50, 60 miles, then all of a sudden the wheels start turning and you get into this zone and all of a sudden that sort of goes away. So that's just another thing that I sort of think about when I'm out there is like not – that goes back to not pushing too hard, the old cliche, but that's how I sort of monitor that a little bit. If I'm getting burned early, that's got to slow down. You're wasting energy.
I was going to say that might be some of the best advice that we've had in a long time. I don't think I've had anyone on the show that has put it into words like that. If you start feeling the lactic acid, the burn, which we all have at some point on whether it's a really steep climb or it's a flat section, you're just pushing too hard, just pulling back off of that. Because, yeah,
just a little bit. That burn, just a little bit to knock it down. Yep.
Love it. Let's get to some live questions.
Yeah, a question from Nathaniel. Nathaniel asked, of your 40 or so 100-mile race victories, which top finish is the most memorable and why?
A few of my best races. San Diego 100, I ran against Josh Brimhall. I ran 15:48. That was one of my best races ever. I was slamming it all the way to the end. That was, you know, it wasn't the most competitive race ever, but with Josh ran mid-16, so he ran a great race, but he was like, what the hell happened out there? I was just on fire. I had a great race in Massanutten with a Korean guy. The year that I won 600s in 2006, I came in second against this dude, and I ran 17:59. It was an amazing race. It was fantastic. But I think the race that really, again, kind of put me over the edge and had me understand that I want the 100-mile distance is that 2001 Hard Rock, because I was sitting around with my buddy before that race started, and Sports Illustrated was there at that time. National Geographic was there. The magazine was there at that time. They were doing a story on Hard Rock. And I said to my buddy, I said, man, sure would be good to nail one this time, you know, because that was when media about these races really wasn't big or anything. So,
right.
And I nailed it, you know, and I was killing it right to the end. That was a special day. You know, I've had other great races. I ran Grindstone by myself with no crew, and that record stands still, and it's a fast record. Avery Collins can attest to that. He's like, man, that thing was stout, because he ran like an hour and a half slower. And you know, those are the few of the days that were really special. But that Hard Rock 2001 was, it's just, and I ran without a pacer there too, because my pacers actually bailed out on me, which was Ian Torrance and Avery McDowell. And well, you know, those guys were fast. And they're good buddies of mine, but they got injured or something and they couldn't run. I said, well, I guess I'll have to do it alone. So maybe I was running scared through the woods. I don't know. But that was sort of made me think, like, man, I can do this alone. And it wasn't the last day I had pacers, but that was 2004. But still, that was a special day.
That's awesome. Man, I feel like I could just sit and talk to Carl about, like, tell me about this race on this year. And
I don't know how I remember all this stuff, but I –
Well, I mean,
for some I don't even know anything about. So
sure, it's over. Would you say 140 ultras?
About that, yeah.
And I imagine each one of those you're encountering dozens of people that you're probably interacting with during the race, before, after the race. So I imagine the stories are deep and prevalent. I want to talk about Western States specifically this coming Saturday. What is drawing you back? So you've raced this event a couple of times. What is bringing you back? I feel like I know, and I think you've said it out publicly, yeah. But let's talk a little bit about that. What's bringing you back?
Well, it's, you know, as I said, because I've been running ultras for 22 years, and believe it or not, I finally turned 50, and which is incredible because I just blinked and I'm 50. But obviously, the over 50 record is it's the longest standing record at Western, 29 years. Doug Latimer has the record. He's a stout runner. God, he's probably, you know, he's got to be at least 79 now, right? I know he's still around. I hope he shows up. But that's sort of something that, can it seal my legacy? I don't know if it's going to seal my legacy, but I haven't had too many opportunities at Western. And because I've always gone to Hard Rock, not because I wasn't able to get in or anything, but Red Bull was help getting in. As if you look at it, I got in through a sponsor. Red Bull was the sponsor. They helped me out. And I wiggled my way in, and I think this is the time that I can still sort of be relevant. You know, I'm sure I'm getting a little slower, but this is another milestone that I could actually put in the books. And whether or not I'll do it, I mean, don't get me wrong here. I'm not saying I'm going to do it, but I have a chance to do it. So I've really focused it on Western this year because, you know, I'm not injured. I feel good. I ran a couple of tune-up 100s. Some people may say that that's a little much, but it's not for me because I'm used to it, I think. And, you know, now it's my opportunity. I'd like to see it be 80 degrees, don't get me wrong, but, you know, because time would be faster. But I'll embrace the heat and see what happens and just go for it. And that's – Western is a great race. Many people have told me, you won't like Western. It's a road race. It's too fast. It's too smooth. Well, no, it's a mountain race, and it's kind of technical in some places. It's the first time I ran it, I'm like, this is, what do you mean I won't like this race? It's fantastic, you know? And just the buzz around it is awesome. So, I mean, it's the race that started it all, and really, you know, and it could be the race that I finish my career on. We'll see. I always said I'll retire if I actually win the race. I don't see myself winning. So, you know,
we can make some calls.
I would have to retire if I win the race, but I don't see that happening. But, you know, of course, but I hope to just have a good race, and the over 50 record is certainly the goal. And if it doesn't happen, I'll just, you know, move on forward and go to the next one.
The Masters record currently 1842.
It's 1843. That's
1843.
Over 50. So, yeah, the 40 and over record, which is technically mastered. I hate to say it, but I'm a grandmaster. 40 and over is like Mike Morton, and it's like 1545 or something. So that is quite stout. So Browning has his hands full if he can attain that. But, you know, now I'm looking over 50. I'm not racing anyone else except that clock or anyone else who's over 50 ahead of me. Because that would matter.
Yeah, that right, exactly.
You know, that matters.
That's... I'm excited. Like, this brings up just the fact that this race isn't about what's happening at the very, very front of the men's and women's races, right? It's not right. About the first guy, first woman, top three or whatever. There are stories that are woven throughout this race. It's one thing that's drawn us to it, the stories that are there. There was a great question here in the chat room that kind of goes along with that, Kim.
Yeah, Nathaniel asked, Carl, what Western State storylines most interest you?
I'm curious about this. So what are the storylines from this year's race that maybe people can follow along that have interested you?
Well, I like my story, but not just that. I think Ian Sharma is going for his ninth top 10 finish.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty outstanding. And Ian is bomber at this race. Another person to learn from, I think, you know, as far as longevity and all that kind of thing. I think the women's race is going to be great. It's a bummer that Camille is not going to start. But you know what? That doesn't mean the race is over. I think what's interesting is that it was, for a while, it was sort of Camille and Courtney. But I don't think that's the case at all. I think there's nine other girls right behind, not even necessarily behind them, but right in the whole mix. The beauty of all that is I should be around the first women. So the way I look at it is I get to watch this incredible race, you know, around them. You know, a couple might beat me or whatever. It doesn't matter. But the bottom line is I'll probably get to watch that. So that'll be kind of interesting for me. And then, of course, you know, the men's race. I mean, Jim, third time's a charm. Everybody's talking about that. And I mentioned before in just a tweet that I think, or a Facebook post that, you know, I think there's more pressure on Jim to succeed than anything else. And that's only because people are putting it on him. I think Jim's one of the super cool dude. He has the talent to do it. I'm not going to tell him how to run his race. I think he should go out hard just like he does and do his thing. I think he should just do what he wants to do. But there's a lot of other stories in the race. I mean, Jared Hazen is another guy to win. All the guys, so many fast runners in it that, and Francois, I mean, can he handle the heat? Is he as fast? But just, again, 15 hours is a 9-minute mile. That's not that fast, you know? I mean, yeah, it's fast for 100 miles, but it's not. Yeah, you're not out of breath. None of those guys are really out of breath doing it. It's like, how long can your body handle going that type of effort? So I think it's going to be, I'll be asking who's in the front every time I see someone I know, you know, and it'll be interesting. I'm just kind of watching the front from where I am. And I think storylines, you know, I didn't really study it really that hard to get really in depth of who's running and who's doing what. Right. I think Megan, Canfield Arbogast, is that how you say it? I think she's 56 or something. That woman is amazing. So if she runs top 10 again in her 50s, that makes me think I can do that too. I think I can run low 17s if I have a great race. Maybe not when it's 105, you know, or whatever degrees, but
it's not that hot.
110 is not, the 120 is not that hot. The sauna, right? So I think the race will pan out as it pans out. We're going to see carnage. We're going to see great performances. And what happens at the end is really like everyone can criticize at the end. Don't criticize now. Let people do what they want to do. Let us all have fun in our own little way. And let us be challenged, and then we'll see what happens at the finish.
I love it. Carla, I want to talk to you for hours and hours and hours. We got to get you back on the show. There is no doubt about that.
I got all kinds of stories for you.
We're just touching on Western states. I'm like, I don't even want to talk about Western states. I want to talk about Massanutten. I want to go back in time and talk about that.
I was going to say, there's so many people in the chat room saying, I'm going to need to rewatch this episode. Yeah. There's people saying, there's a lot of people in the chat room saying they're sitting here taking notes and this will be an episode to refer back to.
Oh, yeah, no doubt. Yeah, you have, trust us, you probably have at least 100 people who are running states on Saturday who are sitting here watching it, just like taking the notes. Like, what do I got to do?
Well, I'm going to be hiding. I'll be hiding all day Thursday and Friday. So I kind of like to lay low and just kind of like put my feet up and rest, because many times for those people too, you know, standing out in the heat we'll all be at the meeting, of course, but standing out in the heat and things like that, don't walk around and do that stuff. Go lay on your bed and put your feet up, you know? There's no reason to get into all the hype and stuff like that. I know it's exciting, but what's more important is that to put your feet up and rest. And again, that's kind of what I'm doing. I could not run another day until Western States. It would make no difference. The only reason I'm going to run those 4 or 5 miles a day the next couple days, I'm not going to run tomorrow, but Wednesday and Thursday, I'll run like 4 or 5 miles. I'll run them slow, and then I will lay there. That's important. Stay hydrated, you know, and eat well and that kind of thing. And just wait for the start and try not to be nervous. I mean, I'm not nervous at all, whatever. It's important to get your sleep the next couple nights too, because for those that are nervous and don't sleep that well the night before, try to sleep now, you know, try to get as much rest as you can now, blow off work, call in sick, do whatever you got to do. Cause that's going to help you on the start line.
That's like just solid advice, mm-hmm. Solid advice from Carl. Well, man, I really wish I was going to Squaw just so I could watch everything play out over the course of that 24, 38, 48 hours, however it plays out over the weekend. Carl, it was awesome to have you on air, finally get you on the show. I cannot wait to see what you do on Saturday. I hope you get the record. It would be amazing. I know this has been a long time coming. It's something I'm sure you've been wanting to do for quite some time. Give it a shot. I'm really excited, man, and I wish you all the luck in the world, and I know our viewers do as well. We've got hundreds of people here watching live that want to see Carl Meltzer do it. So,
well, we'll see what happens.
Just do it.
I'll give it my best shot. We'll see.
Yeah, no doubt.
I try not to blow up.
We are going to move into the post show with Carl. So if you are a Patreon supporter, we're going to see you there. It doesn't matter what level you're at, dollar or more. Carl's going to join us for a little bit in the post show, and you'll be able to ask all those questions that didn't get asked during the main show. Kim's already pulled probably another dozen aside here. So we're going to get to a lot of those questions in the post show. All you have to do is go to patreon.com/thegingerrunner, and you can join us there. Supports the show, supports the channel. Every film that we make, every review, everything like that supports it. In that capacity. Before we do that, though, while we have Carl here on the main show, something we like to do with all of our first-time guests on the show is a little thing called the Quickie Question Quiz. Carl, this is the first you're hearing about it, but I promise you it's very easy. I have a series of about 10 questions. They're super simple. All you got to do is answer with the first thing that comes to your head. You let me know when you're ready with a thumbs up, and we'll just get right into it. Cool. What was your very first race?
Massabesic Lake Road Race, 5K.
Favorite place to run?
Wind River Mountains, Wyoming.
Road or trails?
Trails.
Bucket list race?
Bucket list race is a tough one because there's so many. But I'd like to do Tour de Jean.
Favorite running movie?
Prefontaine.
Guilty pleasure TV show?
Seinfeld.
We just started watching that one again on Hulu. Pre-race meal. What are you going to have the night before states?
Whatever I feel like having at the restaurant at Squaw Valley. It's funny. People ask me that recently. What's your pre-race meal? I'm like, burger and fries, pizza. I don't know. Whatever looks good. There is no special meal before a hunt.
I imagine it's exactly what you're used to eating. Like, eat what you're normally going to eat anyways.
Yeah, exactly. That won't change anything.
What's the first thing you're going to have after the race? What's your post-race indulgence?
A beer, probably. Well, and, Ultragen, probably. My recovery drink, Ultragen, but a beer as well.
And finally...
Maybe I'll mix it in the beer.
Oh, my God. That thought came to my head, and I kind of went, I hope he doesn't say that. Because that's going to be right a foamy out. Mess. Who knows? And finally... I think I know the answer to this, but what are your current running kicks, or what are you going to race states in? What shoe?
Well, that's an easy one. Speed Goats from Hoka, of course. I love them. I'm psyched about them. And yeah, brand new pair right off the shelf.
Well done with version 2. I really like version 2.
Yeah, version 2 kicks ass for sure. I love
it. It really does. Yep. That's it. You passed. Congratulations. Yay! That's an A plus results right there. That's very, very good.
That's like the new Grandmaster's record.
That is the new Grandmaster's record for the Quickie Question Quiz. Right. Congratulations. Okay, so Carl, let people know who are watching live or maybe watching the archive version of this. Where can they find you on social media if for some reason they want to follow or reach out or follow along with the journey this weekend? Where can they find you? I
mean, of course, Facebook, Carl Meltzer. Twitter is at Speedgo. Twitter's at Speedgo Carl. And Instagram, I don't ever run with my phone, so I never take pictures. I think it's at Meltzer Carl, but I don't run with gadgets. I don't run with phones, so I don't really do much Instagram. And that's only because of that reason. But Twitter, you know, at Spiegel Carl, and then Facebook.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Carl Meltzer, for joining us on Ginger Runner Live. Again, we are going to have Carl join us for just a little bit of the post show. I know he's got a busy schedule. He's got some traveling to do. He's got some legs to kick up and relax. So we're going to move right into the post show with Carl here in just a couple of seconds. If you are a Patreon supporter, head on over there. You can see the link to that post show, and we'll get started in just a couple of seconds. But of course, thank you, everyone, for tuning in tonight, and show Carl some love. Follow him across the social media there that he just listed, and thank him for being on the show, because this was a big one, no doubt. Yep. Am I forgetting anything?
I don't think so.
Cool.
Move it along.
Move it along. All right, guys. We'll see you guys in the post show. Get out there, train hard, race harder, and party the hardest. I know I am. Thanks, guys.
Thanks.
Good night.
Bye.